20 or 30 years ago, one had to fight really hard to get anyone or any institution close to the mainstream of bourgeois society to take Marx seriously. He had been reduced to the margins of intellectual life. Of course, this was particularly true after 1989, the collapse of the Soviet Union, and so on and so forth. But it was true of a longer period, when one had to fight hard, really, to justify being a Marxist. I don't think that's true any longer. And I think that as time goes on, Marx's real grandeur, we're coming up to the bicentenary of his birth in 2018. As time goes on, Marx's grandeur becomes more and more obvious and harder to deny. Now, I'm not going to talk about Marx as a person at all, but incidentally, in a way, an indication of the interest in Marx, there's a Karl Marx walking tour that takes place in London quite regularly, and there's a special tour for people taking part in Marxism on Monday, and you can find details on the programme. So if you want to know more about Marx as a person, don't ask me, go on the walking tour. But it's worth asking, why has Marx's grandeur increased in the last 20 or 30 years? The fundamental reason is, I think, that it's become absolutely evident that the question is capitalism. What dominates the world, how it functions, how politics functions, the future of the planet? What dominates everything is capitalism. I mean, when I was young, on the whole, people in the mainstream didn't want to talk about capitalism, even use the word. Everyone talks about capitalism. Everyone uses it as a reference point. Everyone is concerned about its future. And if capitalism is the question, then that makes Marx really important, because Marx was the key theorist and the great critic of capitalism. Now, when I say Marx was the key theorist of capitalism, let me just make it clear, that doesn't mean I think Marx was always right. I mean, it would be boring if he were always right. He grappled with a very complex set of issues, as I'm going to try and bring out. But nevertheless, if there's a conversation to be had about capitalism, you can't avoid Marx. I mean, of course, in the, you know, at the very heart of the mainstream, they try to avoid thinking about capitalism. That's true of bourgeois economics. I had a debate recently about capitalism with, among others, Paul Krugman, the leading Keynesian economist, and he said when he thought about it, capitalism wasn't a concept that he used. And I said, exactly, that sums up what's wrong with bourgeois economics. So, of course, bourgeois economics doesn't talk about capitalism, and therefore it can provide some sort of very threadbare justification for ignoring Marx. But if you want to talk about capitalism, you've got to look at Marx. Now, as Sarah said, I wrote a book called The Revolutionary Ideas of Karl Marx. I have to say, I wrote it a long time ago. It was written for the centenary of his death in 1983. I mean, I think it's not a bad book, but I wouldn't write it the same way now if I were writing an introductory book about Marx today. And I want therefore to approach the subject in a different way. So if among the elder of you, you've nostalgically come to this meeting hoping that I would go through things in the way in which I did in the Revolutionary Ideas, sorry to disappoint you. What I want to focus on is in particular the theme of the critique of political economy, because Marx famously was very bad at finishing anything that he wrote. But there's a great cycle of works that starts really in the middle of the 1840s, when he was a young man, and only concludes with Capital, the three volumes of Capital, which of course also he never finished, at the end of his life, at the beginning of the 1880s. And all those successive works are either titled or subtitled critique of political economy. That's true most obviously of capital itself. So why is this idea of the critique of political economy so important to Marx? To understand that, one has to begin with, go back in his intellectual and political career. As a young man in Germany, in the early 1840s, Marx became very quickly a radical democrat. For him, the starting point became what he called the critique of politics. He says he came out of an intellectual generation who were preoccupied with Hegel and understanding the great philosopher Hegel and understanding the roots of religion and things like that. But he says the critique of religion is over. Now we're with the critique of politics. And what does the critique of politics for Marx mean? It means essentially achieving in Germany the kind of revolution that happened in France between 1789 and 1794. A radical, thoroughgoing, popular revolution that would tear out the roots of the old feudal regime and establish a radical democratic republic that would unify the whole of Germany. So Marx wanted to see political revolution to achieve what he thought of as a real democracy in Germany. But very quickly, he found that there was a problem about this. When he's looking back on his career in the 1840s, he said, "I soon discovered the embarrassment of material interests." In other words, capitalism started erecting its ugly head. He was involved in an alliance with the liberal capitalists of Cologne. He produced a newspaper in alliance with them that was intended as a critique of the old regime in Germany. And the problem with his allies was that they were prepared to fork up money, but they didn't want Marx to go very far in his criticisms of the existing regime. And he came to realise that that was because of their material interests. In other words, he discovered that you can't see politics as this ideal free-floating zone, independent of grubby everyday material realities. He came to see that politics was shaped and structured and limited by the economic structure of society. He saw everything through categories that he took from the great German philosopher Hegel. And Hegel had seen Hegel saw the state as the kind of accomplishment, the completion, the full realization of modern civil society, as he called it. But Marx turns Hegel on, inverts what Hegel says, and says, in fact, the state is an expression of the profound socio-economic conflicts that exist in civil society. That's the conclusion he was reaching by about 1843, 1844. Okay, so what you have to do then is understand civil society. How do you do that? Later, Marx said, if you want to understand the anatomy, the economic anatomy of civil society, you have to look at political economy. In other words, Marx turned to political economy. This is back to the critique of political economy. Political economy is an intellectual tradition because he thought it could provide him with the tools for understanding the social and economic dynamics of modern society. He doesn't yet call it capitalist society. He's still groping there. And in particular, he finds this among those he calls, this is later, looking back on it, the classical political economists. People like Adam Smith and David Ricardo. People who are giants. People compared to whom contemporary bourgeois economists are, you know, intellectually and morally primitive pygmies. And that's polite. But one of the things that you find first in Smith and developed further by Ricardo is a realistic economics sociology of modern capitalism. They don't call it that, but already in Smith, what are the three main classes of society? Landowners, okay, you know, the landowners have been around for a long time, but then capitalists and labourers. And suddenly into shape begins to emerge the dominant classes of modern capitalist society. Ricardo takes it further. He treats the landowners essentially as a reactionary hangover from feudalism. The key dynamic is between workers and capitalists, and he sees the relations between classes as being conflictual. So, slightly later, Marx says in a letter, I didn't invent the class struggle. Other people had seen it. People like Ricardo and Smith had seen it. But they were limited by the fact that they see capitalism as something natural. They see this society, this economic structure, which is conflictual, they acknowledge, as in some sense corresponding to human nature. The culmination of human history is in capitalist society. Capitalist society represents the fulfillment of human nature. As people sometimes put it, they naturalize capitalism. Capitalism isn't something that can be changed because of the way in which it corresponds to human nature. So this is why we need a critique of political economy. In other words, political economy reveals fundamental insights about the nature of the world in which we live. And let me emphasize, not just the world Marx lived, but the world we continue to live in. But they were held back by what ultimately was an ideological commitment to capitalism, even of the greatest of the political economists like Ricardo and Smith. And so you need a critique of political economy. What does this mean? Well, there's a kind of duality about the critique of political economy. There's a duality about the object of the critique of political economy. In other words, Marx is part, when he undertakes the critique of political economy, he's partly criticizing the theories and the kind of categories, the concepts, that people like Smith and Ricardo, and much more inferior figures, like the vulgar political economists, as he calls them, who are the ancestors of modern neoclassical economics. He criticizes their concepts and categories. And in his economic manuscripts, particularly the manuscript, part of which is published as Theories of Surplus Value, there's incredibly detailed dismantling of their concepts and so on. But Marx isn't doing this as a conceptual exercise. He's not a philosopher. He was trained as a philosopher, but he saw himself going beyond philosophy. He's using the critique of the categories to develop an understanding of what those categories are about, namely the capitalist economic system, which Smith and Ricardo and co. partly reveal, but also, because of their ideological commitment to capitalism, partly conceal. So the critique of political economy is also a critique of capitalism as an economic system. Critique itself as an activity is dual, again, because Marx, as I said, comes out of, was trained as a philosopher in the German classical idealist tradition. And in that tradition, critique doesn't just mean refuting. When you carry out a critique of some theory in this tradition, you're not just saying, this is totally wrong, this is nonsense, this guy's an idiot, and so on and so forth. Here is a demonstration of why his theory is false. You may do some of that. Actually, Marx is always saying, this guy's an idiot. He's far from being uncritical in the conventional way. But more profoundly, critique is to do with establishing the limits of a system of thought. This is what Immanuel Kant does in his philosophy. I don't have time you will be relieved to hear, to go into that. Critique is understanding why a theoretical system makes mistakes, because of its inherent limits. And in the case of the political economists, even the best one, the limits lie in their identification of capitalism with human nature, seeing capitalism as somehow exhausting what's historically possible for human beings. Okay. So, but there's something else. So, critique is about identifying limits. But in Marx, because he's concerned not just with the categories, but with capitalism, what he's trying to discover aren't just the limits to the political economists. That's of secondary interest to him, because he's trying to achieve revolution That's his project. His project is political. I'll come back to that. He's trying to understand how capitalism works, the better to overthrow it. So he's trying to identify what David Harvey, in a famous book, calls the limits to capital. There's a great passage in the third volume of Capital, and Marx says, the true barriers to capitalist production are capital itself. In other words, the reason why capitalism has problems, the reason why we have crises and environmental destruction and class struggle and all these sorts of unfortunate things that happened under capitalism, aren't because they're accidents or mistakes or they're bad policy makers. It's tempting to look, particularly at the European Union at the minute, or George Osborne, and think, you know, things are bad because we're run by complete primitive, stupid bastards. But they are primitive, stupid bastards. But the fact that people of this quality are in charge of political systems is an expression of how capitalism works and the nature of capitalism as a system. They're servants of that system, a system that is defined by very profound antagonisms. Okay, now, so this is what drives Marx's critique of political economy. Now, in the course of developing that critique, Marx forges the concepts of his theory of history. We very often tend to talk about Marx's theory of history or historical materialism, capital H, capital M, as if it's a kind of separate subject. But what you see if you study the development of Marx's work is that he formulates his general theory of history in the course of trying to understand capitalism for a very obvious reason. What he's trying to understand is how societies change systematically. In other words, not just small gradual changes, but above all, they shift from one kind of society to another. Why is he interested in that? Because he's trying to understand two things. Looking backwards, or partly backwards, he's trying to understand how capitalism establishes itself as a system, although this is a process that is still going on in his lifetime. He's also trying to understand, looking forward, how there can be an even bigger change, a change from capitalism to a communist society, a society without exploitation or classes. And he forges the key concepts of his theory of history while developing, in the process of developing his critique of political economy. This is true in lots of ways, his most important concept, the concept of the relations of production. Marx inherits from the political economists another key concept, the idea of the productive forces. The productive forces are the productive powers of humankind that develop over time with greater knowledge and more sophisticated technology. And the political economists see the history of humankind as the expansion in the productive powers of humankind. Marx says, yes, that's part of the story, but there's another side. There's another side which is to do with the fact that production isn't just about technology and skills and labour forces and all that kind of thing. Production is also about who controls the process of production and who benefits from it. The relations of production, it's a key concept that he formulates in the course of criticising the ideas of the French socialist Proudhon. In the mid-1840s, the relations of production are the relations of economic power that govern any particular economic system. And this concept is formulated so that he can understand capitalism. Because for him, capitalist relations of production, the relations of economic power that prevail in our modern societies, are defined by two fundamental antagonisms. First of all, of course, the antagonism between capital and wage labour. I don't have time to elaborate it. There are other sessions which go into it. The way in which you can show, using the labour theory of value developed by Smith and Ricardo, so here Marx is building on the classical political economists, using the labour theory of value, but improving on it as Marx does, you can show how the profits of capital derive from the exploitation of wage labour. And wage labour isn't just you know, a technical prerequisite of production. Wage labour is a key dimension of the structure of economic power under capitalism. Wage labour means that most people lack direct access to the productive resources that they need to support themselves and their dependents. So in order to live, in order to support their dependents, they have to go onto the labour market and sell their labour power. And they do so on terms that, because that's all they've got, their labour power, they don't have the financial resources the capitalists have, they do so on terms that lead to their exploitation. Incidentally, you know, why is George Osborne slashing working credits? It's to save money, partly, but it's also a reinforcement of the whole logic of the policies that have been pursued here since Thatcher to weaken the bargaining power of workers and make the process of surplus value extraction more efficient and more productive for the capitalists. But there's a second profound antagonism, because just looking at the exploitive relationship between capitalists and workers, it just looks like capitalists are really bad people. And we go back to personal abuse, which Marx engages in, you know, at great length in Capital. If you read Capital Volume 1, you know, what he says about the capitalists is a very pleasurable experience, and you can think of contemporary examples of it and so on. But you can't simply rely on the idea that capitalists are evil, tempting though it is. What Marx says is that there's a second profound antagonism to capitalism, which is the antagonism among capitals themselves. In other words, the capitalist class isn't a unitary entity, a unified body. Capitalists themselves are constantly competing with each other. The capitalist class is inherently fragmented into rival capitals. Marx says capital as a overall social relation can only exist as many capitals. Capitals, plural, capitals as the individual units of the system. And these units constantly compete with each other. And it is this competition, Marx says, that places the individual units on the system, places upon them the imperative to operate as capitals. In other words, if an individual unit of the system decides to be very benevolent, to stop exploiting workers, to cut the working day, you know, generally to create a pleasant working environment, unless something very surprising happens, that capital will be driven out of business because its costs will rise higher than its competitors. So there's a constant pressure through competition of firms to exploit more efficiently, to introduce more advanced technologies, to cut their costs. And this drives the whole process of capital accumulation and drives the whole process of capitalist crisis. I don't have time to go into it, but Marx's theory of the tendency of the rate of profit to fall, something else that you'll find sessions devoted to at this Marxism, the tendency of the rate of profit to fall is a product essentially of the process of accumulation. Capitalists, under the pressure of competition, investing more and more in technology, in means of production, in machinery and so on, what Marx sometimes calls dead labour, and relatively investing less and less in workers. The problem with that is it's the workers' labour that is the source of the value, the new value on which the system depends. And therefore, there's a tendency for the rate of profit to fall. Marx also says that that tendency is the expression within capitalism of the conflict between the development of the productive forces and the relations of production. He says that what drives societies historically to destructive crisis is the way in which the prevailing structure of economic power, the prevailing relations of production, tend to hold back the further development of the productive forces. The form this takes in capitalism is the tendency of the rate of profit to fall, because more and more efficient production is leading to a fall in the rate of profit, which in turn leads to capitalists stopping investing, crises, the destruction of capital in crises, unemployment, huge wastage of resources and so on and so forth. So Marx sees capitalism as governed by the broader historical laws that he tries to develop in his theory of history. Okay, how are we doing? 10 minutes, yes, good. Glad we agree. Okay, so that's a very quick sketch of Marx's critique of political economy, and I've taken it to the key point, the way in which he shows that capitalism is a system that's driven towards crises. Crises aren't accidents, but are regular and predictable consequences of the particular character of capitalist relations of production and the antagonisms that define them. Okay, but here we reach the point where the critique of political economy ceases to be a purely theoretical critique. There's a passage that Marx wrote when he was a young man that I've always particularly liked, where he says, the arm of criticism cannot replace the criticism of arms. He liked those sorts of, I forget, there's a technical name for those figures of speeches. The arm of criticism cannot replace the criticism of arms. In other words, it's all very well to say that the Prussian monarchy, I think was what he was talking about in this passage, is really bad and is irrational and undemocratic, but we're going to have to get together and overthrow it in the way in which the French people did between 1789 and 1794. In other words, for Marx, the critique of political economy is not a theoretical exercise. It has an ineradicably practical dimension. Because what, through his early grappling with the critique of politics, Marx grasped was the kind of democratic revolution that he was aspiring to could only be successful as a social revolution. It could only succeed if it didn't simply get rid of the existing political regimes and the hangovers of the old feudal regime. Achieving a modern bourgeois democratic republic wouldn't be enough. It wouldn't achieve what he called in one crucial early text, human emancipation. What was required was a social revolution that, as time went on, he came to see would require the overthrow of capitalism and the achievement of a communist society. What you needed, to use the language of the present, the jargon of the present, is not regime change, but change in mode of production, getting rid of capitalism altogether. Now, it's very important to understand that when Marx analyzes the economic logic of crises, he's not saying that crisis of itself is going to lead to the overthrow of capitalism. Absolutely not. His analysis of crisis is quite subtle. He sees he calls crises temporary and violent resolution of the contradictions. And the key word there, just to seize on for a minute, is resolution. In other words, crises are produced by the contradictions of the system, but they resolve them, temporarily, but they resolve them. In crises, capital is destroyed, firms go bankrupt, machinery and so on can be bought much more cheaply. Very importantly, unemployment rises, workers can be squeezed more, they can be exploited more. That means that the total amount of capital in the system is reduced and the total mass of profits, of surplus value, is increased. So crises serve a function within the system. They push back the rate of profit to a level where the system can start expanding again. So crises aren't going to lead to the breakdown of capitalism. Later Marxists thought you could prove that there was an economic logic that would lead to the complete breakdown of capitalism. This is not Marx's argument at all. So when you read a textbook where some idiot says Marx was an economic determinist, he thought that capitalism was bound to collapse, this is not true, completely untrue. Capitalism has to be overthrown through collective and self-conscious action. And this is the other side to Marx's thought, which develops particularly when he's developing his critique of political economy, particularly in the early phases, in the 1840s and the 1850s. I said that the very idea of the critique of political economy has a number of dualities, but Marx, in a way, his key concept of exploitation also has a duality, because Marx is saying about exploitation that, of course, it's cruel and unjust and horrible that workers are exploited. But exploitation has another side. What's happening is workers' labour is creating the surplus value from which the capitalist profits and capital comes from. That means the workers have power. That means that the capitalists are dependent on the workers. The critical thing is workers have got to get collectively organised. So long as workers are a collection of atomised individuals, then the capitalists can continue their exploitation of the workers. So, of course, the Tories are introducing more anti-union legislation because they would like, as far as possible, a highly atomised and weak working class. Because it's when the more workers are collectively organised, the more they have the ability to assert their power against capital. The more the other side to exploitation, not just the screwing of surplus value out of workers, but the dependence of capital on workers becomes visible. And Marx sees this, and therefore, for Marx, at the core of the class struggle is the development of the working class as a collective subject, not just a mass of atomized suffering individuals, but as a collective of workers who exercise agency as a collective, who act through their shared organisation. And he sees workers' organisation growing, becoming more than trade union organisation, becoming increasingly politically self-conscious. Now, there are issues to be raised about how Marx conceives this process of the development of the working class into a subject. I think it's arguable that he sees this as happening too much automatic. He thinks of this as a process that will go inevitably through certain stages and reach a culminating point where workers are so militant and so powerful and so well organised that they'll get rid of the bosses. I think it's a much more open process than that. But nevertheless, the crucial point that he's putting there, that the resolution to the crisis of capitalism depends upon, is one that will take place in practice. As Gramsci put it, the overcoming of the tendency of the rate of profit to fall requires political praxis, requires collective action. And this is connected to the final point I want to make of all. What the transformation of workers from atomized individuals into a collective subject underlines that when Marx talks about achieving communism, he's not talking about a process that takes place automatically. He's not talking about a process that will be achieved through some sort of elite on behalf of the working class, whether a reformist elite or a terrorist elite or whatever. For him, the achievement of communism is a process of self-emancipation. It's workers' growing collective organisation and confidence, their sense of their own power that is crucial. And I think we can see we can get a hint of that in some of the events that we see around us at the present time. Anyone who says, for example, the Greek government seems to be in the process of capitulating, accepting the terms that were rejected in the referendum less than a week ago. That's terrible. Does that mean the referendum was a waste of time? No. Because what the referendum precisely represented was a stage in the process of collective self-emancipation of the Greek working class. The Greek working class asserting themselves as a collective political subject that can impose solutions not just on the Greek bosses, not just on the Eurogroup, but also on their own government. And that's how we have to see revolution, as people, the working people, reaching a stage where they have the confidence and organisation to take control of society. And this is the culmination point of Marx's critique of political economy.
Paul Shackley, Lancaster, SWP. It is just a question to Alex. As I understand it, Marx said not only that there is a boom-slump cycle built into capitalism, but also that over time the booms got smaller and the slumps got deeper and longer and so forth. Now, that sounds to me as if it could lead eventually to a great big slump that becomes a final collapse, you know, a collapse of society, so the common ruin of the contending classes, maybe. Now, I know that's oversimplistic, but unless and until there is a revolution, a genuine revolution, how is it that capitalism manages to avoid that happening? How do they eventually get out of the boom's getting smaller and the slump's getting deeper and prevent a final collapse? Thanks.
Yeah, I'm John Parrington from Oxford. Yeah, I think it's really important to recognise, as Alex is saying, about the kind of scientific value of Marx's work, because we often hear about him as the kind of the evolutionary, the ideologue, or the rest of it, which is a bit ironical given that, you know, mainstream economics, the rest of it, is driven by ideology. But I think it's really important to keep stressing how scientific Marx's view is. I mean, there was a survey, as a biologist, I was quite interested, there was a survey recently of the greatest thinkers in science that was conducted by Nature magazine, the prestigious science magazine, and Marx was actually the person who came up top, which might surprise some people, but for me, makes complete sense, given that, for me, is the ultimate in kind of scientific way of looking at the world. And I think it is important, because although we can agree amongst ourselves about the value of Marx, this doesn't stretch to a lot of places, universities and things. I mean, for my sins, I teach at medicine, Oxford University, and I go to lunch most days with my college and talk to, you know, experts in, you know, geography and history and economics and the rest of it. But it's interesting, when I talk to the economists and ask questions like, you know, can you explain the crisis of 2007 and that kind of thing, they'll come out with things like, well, I only study microeconomics. I don't really cover the macroeconomics kind of things. And they never seem to have the answers. And I think it's really important to be able to say, well, actually, there was a person who can explain all of this. But I think the other important thing that means a lot to me as a biologist is that I think Marx's kind of way of looking at the world goes a lot further than just being able to explain the social world, the economics, the rest of it. Because his dialectical method, it can seem a kind of an off-putting word, abstract word, dialectics, but this idea that you can, you know, look at the whole of a complex system, the whole is influenced by the parts and the parts influence the whole. It's a way of looking at the world that is incredibly important. And we're learning this in biology, actually. The more we look into things like how the genome relates to the environment and how the brain develops and how it works as an organ, we learn that really this simplistic ideas of reductionism, which tried to say that, you know, everything can be reduced to its elements. There was Francis Crick, who discovered the structure of DNA, once said that biology can be reduced to physics and chemistry. I think that's equivalent to Margaret Thatcher's statement that there's no society, just individuals. It's a very, I think, wrong way of looking at the world. And actually what we're learning is that we need this kind of more complex vision to understand how the brain works, how the genome actually relates to the organism and the rest of it. And I think also it means kind of locating the fact that we stand in a tradition that's much richer than just, it doesn't just go back to Marx, it comes from the Romantics, people like Goethe, people like Hegel, and we should be proud that we stand in that tradition that started to question those kind of simple ways of looking at the world, but ultimately, obviously, it's about practice, it's about changing the world. But I think we should be proud that we are scientifically analysing the world as a way to change the world and make it a better place. Because just to end on one point,
okay,
one
of
the
distressing
things I think about the situation today is that for all, you know, genetics and modern wonders of technology, you know, we've still got kids who are dying for lack of water in Africa, and that's what we want to change, that situation.
Hello, my name's Jennifer. I'm from Socialist Worker Party in Sheffield and also co-organised Sheffield Disabled People Against the Cuts. I've got a question, really. As well as, or apart from, the pamphlets and various volumes that we know about, what are the processes of galvanisation of workers outside of the trade union movement, etc., given that a lot of labourers at the time may not have had an education that would have enabled them to make sense of these theories? Would they, as we could today, benefit from realising and sharing among our class?
Hi, I'm glad to hear that in universities people have heard of Marx again, but it's interesting that I had a conversation in, I think it was 1969, with the brother of a friend of mine. This is one of the advantages of university education, you meet all sorts of people. She was from a rich family. Her brother was what they called an investment banker in those days, and we got into a discussion. She was afraid he was going to kick us out because we needed somewhere to stay in London, And she said to me, for God's sake, shut up with your Marxist nonsense. And he said, no, he said, actually, the analysis is perfectly right. The difference is he doesn't like it. I make profits from it. And they've always bloody known it. This is the truth. I mean, with the plain truth of the matter is that Marx undoubtedly, he's not perfect, nobody ever was. He didn't know what we know. But the truth of the matter is, and he also didn't see the technologies that we see. And I would personally, being an optimist, tend to maintain that we are now in a much better position to achieve socialism than Marx would ever have been, because there weren't the technologies around for information transfers, and there weren't the complexity of our societies. But if we don't start pushing, if we don't do our bit, if we don't get revolutionary parties working, growing, and educating within groups of people to try and act as antidotes to the other rubbish that is being poured at them all the time, to keep them quiet, to keep them confused. One of the major functions of your classic economists, of course they don't know how to solve the crisis. That's not their job. Their job is to excuse the crisis. And if we don't do something about explaining and getting on to people, then God knows we will see boom and bust and boom and bust and boom and bust forever. And the answer to how do they avoid the next one, it's the good old horseman of the apocalypse. It's colonialism, pestilence, famine and war. That's how they avoid the next final collapse. They just come up with something new. And, you know, they've presumably got something else brewing at the moment.
So, after this comrade, have the comrade over there in the hat.
Okay, hello, comrades. I'm Petros Konstantinou from SEC, sister organization of Socialist Workers Party in Greece. Marx is quite relevant in what is happening in Greece. You can't explain crisis without referring to Marx's analysis. Otherwise, you end in racism. You say that Greece is a peculiar place, and the explanation for crisis is that workers are too lazy. And you have workers who are working from the morning to the night, as they were working 150 years ago. The explanation of the crisis is very crucial to understand what's happening there. The capitalists are lazy, they don't invest. We have to explain that. So this is the objective situation to understand the crisis. But also you have to add, who can change these things? And without the reference of who is the subject of social change, and it is the working class. And I think that the last week in Greece, we got a good example of what is happening with the working class. This referendum, it was the most clear example of class polarization. Absolutely, the workers voted for no, and the upper classes, they voted for yes. So, and this was a product of the mobilization, of the mass mobilization of the workers, the confidence that they built it through 30 general strikes, that they can fight back against the bankers. The bankers, they are not right, and the workers, they have the right. And the last thing that it is very relevant in Greek politics is that we have a left government. Alexis Tsipras and the Syriza party, they try to use the capitalist state to make things better as they think. The reality is that you cannot use the state. You have to go back to Marx, you have to smash the state and replace it with something better. Marx spoke about the experience of the workers in Paris Commune. But I think that in modern Greek politics, we can see what's happening with the workers when they are more confident, given all the political fights, the fight against austerity, the fight against racism, and the fight against fascism. This makes us optimistic that his analysis is very relevant today.
So, and next we'll have just a comrade over there in the blue top. Yeah.
Hello, my name's Alushala Adesanya. I come down with the Sheffield Bunch. What it is, because the subject was ideas for revolution, I've got an idea for a solution, and it's regarding the monetary system. Now, the monetary system has been illegal since the gold went off since 1933, before the Second World War. Now, we're going to need to make a legal monetary system for the whole world. So it's a global solution, and I'm calling it the People's People Tender. Now, instead of using gold and precious metals and stones to make up, and there's always not enough of that to go around, we always manipulate the people tender so it's worth more than these precious metals and gold, and which usually has a market value that can be understood by economists. Now, it can be used to back every currency, so you can use it to back a new global currency. So we could unite the world for peace and prosperity with a global currency, basically, is what I'm trying to say. It's very simple, but it's sometimes it's hard for people to understand how simple it is when with all the conflicts and when the government make us fight over breadcrumbs and all this kind of business. It's a bit abstract, I thought. But I'll leave you with that. The people's people tender instead of gold, and you always manipulate it higher than what gold is, much, much higher. So you just think of how much each individual person's worth throughout their lifetime anyway, with living costs, etc. Thank you.
The comrade from Greece talked about the relevance of Marx today. The other dimension that is so important is the international dimension. And it crops up in the most unexpected places, not alone the most recent demonstrations that we've all been involved on with the Greek flag and the instinctive, spontaneous solidarity with Greek workers, but sometimes in most unusual things. For example, in the Irish anti-water movement, which was, you know, seemingly a single issue and so on, in a working class area of Dublin, instinctively people wanted people from the Greek movement to come and speak to them, and in a working class area of, you know, that had never seen this kind of international meeting, an activist from Thessalonica came along and talked about water, and the connections were automatically there. And so I think it's so important to remember what was being said there about a collective subject, because although ideas and, you know, ideas about tender and so on can be attractive, the thing about Marx is that he says it's an objective condition of the working class that forces it always to struggle, sometimes in, you know, hidden and sometimes open. And we in Ireland experienced, you know, 4 years of long, difficult time where the austerity was hitting us, but suddenly, unexpectedly, we never expected it, in all the working class areas, there was just an objective thing. They could not pay for the water charges. And this came out of nowhere. And it's connected and self-organized and was incredible. And so therefore the collective subject, which isn't taught so much about in academia. In academia, they talk, you know, a lot about how capitalism works and power and so on, but they don't talk about class. And what people who have been involved in politics have reminded when you see these spontaneous revolts is that the working class comes out, it has to. The second thing is the political dimension of it, because when we went into the Yes campaign, Yes for Marriage Equality in Ireland, we were worried that maybe in working class areas, because it was the government calling for it, maybe there would be a kind of throw out the government. Not a bit of it. In working class areas, there was the strongest political generalisation against the Yes vote. And in fact, the highest area was a working class area, Ballyfermot, you know, with an 80% yes for marriage equality. So those two things of an objective class, but subjective politics, that revolutionaries also need to put in and take further are the key lessons that we can take. We can see them in Ireland, we can see them in Greece and be inspired by that.
Okay, and then this comrade just here, yeah.
Yeah, it was really nice to hear Alex talk about the Karl Marx critique of Adam Smith around human nature, because it was when I was a university student that one of my lecturers, who called himself a post-Marxist, I never quite worked out what he meant by that, but he gave us this article on Karl Marx and Adam Smith and Marx's critique of human nature. And I just found it one of the most illuminating things I'd ever read in my life, actually, up until that point. And I'd been involved in various different movements. It was the early 90s. I was probably six when Thatcher came to power. So, my God, I was anti-Tory. I was fighting against racism in the British National Party. All these different things were going on. And in the middle of it, I got given this piece of work which actually blew away some of the most basic justifications which were given for capitalism, that somehow it was inherently part of human nature, that people were competitive, that people were greedy, and that this is always the argument that's used to undermine it. And of course, Marx turns it on his head, because he says, if people survive or live in a system in which you have to compete with your fellow workers to get a job, then actually being a competitive is a prerequisite to survival under this system, and therefore you can't say this is a fixed part of human nature. Human nature is shaped by what goes on around it. In other words, you know, being determined consciousness and not the other way around. And it was a really, I think, liberating thing actually to read at that time. The other thing which I thought was really interesting about the talk as well is that, you know, there's a small pamphlet by Lenin, and it's called The Three Component Parts of Marxism. And I think it picks up really on the elements that bring, that inform Marx's political economy. The German philosophers, where, you know, of course, when Marx looks at Hegel, but he turns it on its head, he turns the dynamic on its head. But what's important is that he identifies what are the contradictions within this society, what are the struggles within this society that are taking place on a day-to-day basis. Because when you have struggle and you have contradiction, you can have different outcomes. You can have an input on that struggle. Then you look at the British political economists of Smith and Ricardo, who, of course, are writing at a time when capitalism is actually a very new system. And they're writing to try and defend that system. It's a very good, I think it's a good and honest analysis of capitalism in comparison to a lot of the bourgeois economists who come later. But, of course, for them, the whole point is to try and defend capitalism. And Marx is not tied down by that at all. Then, of course, the reality of the French workers, you know, where actually what you see is people who are putting into practice an attempt to try and fight back and try and struggle and try and change things. And those three component parts actually start to form the basis of Marx's political economy. And it's interesting as well what people are saying about how did Marx relate to people. And there's a question that was asked earlier by Jen from Sheffield. Because actually Marx and Engels were authors of a number of different revolutionary papers. The idea that these were people who were stuck in the British Library, all they did was spend their lives writing books, is just not true. They were active revolutionary parts of different struggles that were taking place at the time. And their relationship to international workers' movements is something that people is well documented, that people should read. And in actual fact, you think about the Communist Manifesto, written on the eve of 1848 revolutions that took place, that swept across Europe. The Communist Manifesto was something that Marx and Engels wrote as a response to international workers' movements, and it was supposed to be a tool in the hands of the working class in terms of fighting for, but not just for democracy and political democracy, but fighting for economic democracy as well. So anybody who tries to put Marx in an academic box actually needs to blow that out of the water. Here is a revolutionary who is trying to arm us with the ideas and the weapons that we need to overthrow these people who are oppressing us and exploiting us on a daily basis.
I mean, the last speaker said a lot of what I was going to say as well. It has been remarkable, as Alex described at the beginning, how much Marx has been brought into the mainstream just in the time I've been politically active. At first, it was a common sense accepted, even in the anti-capitalist movement, that you can't talk about Marx anymore. That's of the past. We've moved on. Then the economic crisis happens. I mean, I was starting an economics course the week Lehman Brothers collapsed. And so we asked the teachers, what's happened? You know, why isn't that in your graph? And he says, well, look, we assume perfect knowledge of the future. We assume markets clear efficiently. Basically, we assume that the real world doesn't exist. And obviously, since then, that has made Marx very, very relevant. But I think what we've also seen is an attempt to sort of do to Marx, kind of a bit like what they've done to Nelson Mandela, of whether you can't deny someone anymore, so you try and tame them. And I mean, you know, say Nelson Mandela, because he was once on the list of terrorists wanted by the US state. Now, you know, world leaders who've committed terrible wars talk about him like he's Santa Claus. I think with Marx, it's brilliant. You can now buy the Communist Manifesto in supermarkets. But, like, you can also get a Visa card with Marx's face on it. And I think it comes back to what the previous speaker says. They have to accept, to some extent, the validity of his analysis. But Marx wasn't just sitting back and analysing things. And I think you know, what John started with is a great point to come back to for that. Marx was a scientist, and what do scientists do? They don't just sit back and compliment contemplate the world. They interact with it, they experiment with it, and see what comes out of the experiments. The reason Marx understands the world better than these people is because he was constantly involved in a struggle to change it, in a struggle to transform it. That's how you see its true nature, and the only reason we're interested in seeing its true nature is so that we can complete that project of change and destroy all these people.
Yeah, I was really interested in Alex's introduction, and in terms of how he explained how it's in the nature of capitals as part of capitalism to compete. Now, and we can see that clearly in the sense of bringing on the crisis in terms of the sort of feeding frenzy between capitals looking for new markets in terms of housing in the USA, ending up in going after the subprime mortgage market. And tipping the thing into crisis, and similarly with Greece, you know, when Greece joined the euro, you know, there was a sort of a feeding frenzy to buy into, you know, infrastructure projects, you know, such as the Olympics, stacking up big debts. But I was just finished with a question for Alex, really, and it's like he mentioned about the falling rate of profit and the tendency of capitalism to go into crisis on a long-term basis because you get a bigger ratio of technology compared to labour. I'm just wondering why that should be the key, you know, driver of crisis. Isn't it the competition between capitals that you know, that is a key driver? Surely, even if the ratio changes between labour and capital, that means that workers become more productive. I mean, there's a consequence of that is that more workers become thrown on the dole because of the new technology, which perhaps limits their ability to consume the products of capital. So, I mean, just like to answer that, please. Thanks.
It seems to me that one of the most important things about Marx and Marxism is that in opposition to those people who have a vision of wanting to see a better society and come up with a scheme, and very interesting, very important that people do this and speculate about the future of humanity, what's central to Marx is that he points to a force inside of the existing society which is capable of changing it from within. We talk about the working class, we talk about the struggle which is embedded, essential to capitalism. Capitalism oppresses us, people necessarily will fight back in all sorts of ways, under all sorts of different circumstances. And I think that's key to understanding the process of historical change. In other words, Marxism, in the end, is not talking about socialism being something handed down from above, whether it's by a guerrilla army coming down from the mountains or whether it's electing a bunch of MPs in Parliament. I think it's quite interesting that one of the leaders of the Labour Party, Harold Wilson, in the late 60s and early 70s, said that he never got past the first page of reading Capital. And I suspect that subsequent Labour leaders got even less far with it because their basis seemed to be to be supporting the running of the capitalist system. They were under pressure from below to try and change things, but they never could because they never focused on the idea that at root, capitalism is about exploiting the working class. The working class have the power, as we saw a glimmer of on the tube strike just recently, and we see all over the world. So the key point about Marxism, a materialist philosopher, a materialist understanding of the world, and pointing to the real power inside a society which can rise up and ultimately smash capitalism. It's the working class. That's where we have to focus our energies. But of course it means taking that argument into all the existing struggles, all the existing movements, and raising that debate and saying, how do we change the world? How do we get rid of capitalism? How do we build a different sort of society?
This is a question. One of the things that never fails to amaze me about capitalism is the hypocrisy of the people who run the system. And it's a question about China. People will be maybe aware, if you're following the news, that the Chinese stock market has been going through a crisis, and it's lost, I think, something like 30% of its value in the last few weeks. Now, in response to that, the Chinese government, as far as I am aware, have banned the sale of shares, certain shares, in the Chinese stock market. Now, you would have thought, given the fact that we've been preaching free market capitalism here, that this would have taken a further nosedive in shares. But what's actually happened is that the share price has actually recovered. So what the hell's going on there? Alex, can you let us know?
Okay, I'll bring Alex back.
Okay, thanks. China, simple question. Although China is a very successful capitalist economy, it's still very much dominated by the state. And one of the things that the state has done is try to ensure that labour is as cheap as possible and that it's as easy as possible to invest. One thing that means is that interest rates are very, very low. So if you save, and that's good for companies, but it's not very good if you're, you know, trying to save up for your old age or something like that. Rather a preoccupation with me. That makes the stock market quite important politically. From the point of view of the Chinese government, if more and more what are called middle-class people in China, it's not a scientific definition of middle-class, but anyway, slightly more prosperous workers have got involved in the stock market, share prices rise, that serves politically as a compensation for the very low level of interest rates. So it's politically important for the Chinese government for share prices continue to rise. It's very bizarre because the stock market in China is dominated by big Chinese companies, which are predominantly state-owned. So people are speculating in the shares of companies that are ultimately underwritten by the state. So it's a very peculiar stock market. But in any case, the Chinese government is worried that if the stock market collapses and pauperizes substantial sections of the relatively economically small people who've been investing in the market, this will have political ructions, and they're desperate to avoid discontent. And this involves a mixture of stick, you know, different forms of repression, but also quite a lot of carrot. So it's all to do with the carrot. Or that's what I understand about it. Draw what conclusions you want to from that you like. On what Alicia said about reforming money, I mean, this is something that people again and again in the history of capitalism have focused on, because it is ridiculous that our lives are governed by money. In the past it was gold, these days it's these weird paper symbols that are issued by different banks and that whose exchange rates fluctuate on international money markets. It seems ridiculous that our lives are governed by it, but then you discover that they really are governed by it when the banks are shut, as they are in Greece, and you can't get access to any money. And people often draw the conclusion that if we could somehow create a more rational monetary system, this will solve the problems of capitalism. And there were lots of people that Marx debated with during his life, like Proudhon, like various British socialists and so on, who focused on monetary reform. But Marx argued that that capitalism needs what seems like a very irrational monetary system, because it needs, because among other things, it serves as a way of regulating our lives and imposing on discipline on us that we can't exercise a control over. The struggle for the euro that we see developing in such a dramatic way in Greece is more than anything else about ways of ensuring that neoliberal economic discipline is imposed on all of us, not just in Greece, but more generally in Europe and in other parts of the world. So the apparently irrational forms of money that prevail in the world are actually very rational from a capitalist point of view. And therefore, if we want to get rid of that irrationality, we have to get rid of capitalism altogether. Okay, tendency of the rate of profit to fall. The connection, there's a close connection between competition and the tendency of the rate of profit to fall. Capitalists are competing with each other. They want to grab a larger share of the market. That means they have to cut their costs. On the whole, ultimately, the most efficient way of doing that is to invest more in means of production and less in workers. Why? One reason why Osborne wants to increase the minimum wage is because he thinks that that will encourage companies to economise in workers, to lay off workers because they become more expensive, and to invest more in technology. So he's trying to enforce the general logic of capitalism on workers. The general logic is that competition pushes capitalists to invest more in machines, technology of different sorts, and less in workers. That causes a fall in the rate of profit because it's the workers that create the surplus value that is the source of the profit. Now, that then leads to Paul's question, which at the very start of the discussion was, which was, okay, there's a cycle of boom and slump, but doesn't Marx think that crises are going to get worse over time? I think that's what he thought, and there's a sense in which that, I think, is true. Because you see, what's crucial to a slump restoring the efficiency of capitalism is what Marx calls the destruction of capital. In other words, firms are driven out of business in a crisis, and that means their assets can be bought up cheap, their wages are pushed down because of higher unemployment, and the system can start expanding again. But what we saw in the course of the 20th century was what Marx calls the concentration and centralization of capital. In other words, the individual units of the system become bigger. You know, we have, you know, oligopolies, multinational corporations, and they dominate larger and larger sectors of the economy. That's the concentration and centralization of capital. That means it's much riskier to allow the destruction of capital to take place. If you let a really big multinational firm go bust, then you may threaten the viability of whole national economies or all sectors of the global economy. We saw this very clearly in the crisis in 2007, 2008. I mean, the banks were bankrupt, but very few of them actually went bust because the British, American, European ruling classes were terrified that if they did go bust, that would destroy the financial system. That kept within the system very large quantities of unprofitable capital. It also happened to productive sectors of capital. Obama forced into bankruptcy two of the three big American car firms, General Motors and Chrysler. And then he forced, then the government rescued the bankrupt firms, it took them over, and as the condition, there are always conditions with rescues, and the conditions are worse than the rescue. The conditions were that the unions had to accept all sorts of cuts in wages and conditions, which made those firms ultimately profitable. So what you see in crises is much less destruction of capital than is necessary to allow the system to return to full-scale profitable growth. I mean, what we've seen for the last few decades is capitalism, particularly in the West, in the US and Europe, suffering from chronic problems of profitability. And some, even Marxist economists, say this is nonsense. You can't have a crisis of profitability that goes on for decades. If you look at the figures produced by people like Michael Roberts, there is a crisis of profitability. But you let the discussion go on quite a long time. I need a bit of time to reply. There is a prolonged crisis of profitability, which reflects the fact there's been insufficient destruction of capital. So in that sense, you still see a cycle of boom and slump, but we're talking about a capitalism that is suffering from chronic difficulties, and not just in the West, as we see in China. Just two last points. Jennifer asked a very important question about, you know, to what extent, let's put it like this way, was Marx interested in more broader issues than just those of organised workers? And this is an important question, because in Marx's time, the unions organised a small minority of, on the whole, well-paid and highly skilled workers. And Marx did work with those unions, but particularly in the First International, in the 1860s, he fought for them to take up broad political questions. So when the American Civil War caused a terrible industrial crisis in Britain because it cut off the raw material, cotton, on which the British textile industry depended, Marx was involved in a actually very successful campaign by the British labour movement to give solidarity to the North in its struggle against slavery. Similarly, and closer to home, Marx argued very strongly for the unions in Britain to support Irish independence, because he saw the racism of Victorian Britain as being the racism that divided so-called native English Protestant workers from Catholic Irish migrant workers. The Irish were the migrants of the 19th century industrial revolution. And he said, therefore, supporting the fight for Irish independence is critical to the British working class's ability to fight its own ruling class. So Marx didn't just focus on, if you like, the narrow preoccupations of relatively well-organised and well-paid workers. Final point is this. Dave Sewell made a very important point. The difference between philosophy and science is that philosophy simply, maybe very illuminatingly, develops from one concept to another. Science involves an interaction between theory and the world. Science tries to test out its ideas on the world simply than spinning out speculation. Now, with someone like John Parrington, who spoke earlier, well, I assume, I don't know, but as a biologist, the way in which he interacts with the world is in a laboratory. How does Marxism as a science interact with the world? The answer is through political practice. And the equivalent of the laboratory is the revolutionary political organisation. Georg Lukács, the great Hungarian Marxist, put it very well. Organisation is the connection between theory and practice. Through being organised together as revolutionaries, we test out not just Marxist ideas, but the ideas of later Marxists, even our own ideas. We test them out in practice and then come back to debate the success of that practice in order to be more effective in the future. So the idea that collectively we're strong is true, but it applies to revolutionary organisation and it applies to revolutionary theory as well. So there's a direct link between how we understand Marxism and the fact that we seek to build in the SWP and its counterparts like SEC in Greece and others all over the world, the Irish Socialist Workers' Party. There's an organic connection between that practice of building revolutionary organisations and how we understand Marxism. And I'll say, you know, if you're not in the SWP or one of these equivalent organisations, please hurry up and join us.